live on ABC Radio, Brisbane and Queensland.
Now, I reckon you've heard of the Queensland Reconciliation Awards. If you haven't, they're awarded to Indigenous organisations and businesses and recognise initiatives going above and beyond their core business to foster reconciliation and pave the way for a better future for our state. And, of course, the usual awards ceremony couldn't be held in 2020, but one of the winners was the Indigenous Wellbeing Centre, which took out the Premier's Reconciliation Award. Janette Young is from the centre. Hello and congratulations.
Well, thank you very much.
So tell us about the Indigenous Wellbeing Centre. What's its mission? What do you do?
Well, the Indigenous Wellbeing Centre is an Aboriginal community-controlled organisation in central Queensland, but we actually operate in terms of delivering cultural services right across Australia. So we deliver cultural responsiveness training right across Australia online, and our mission is reconciliation in action. That's what we do every single day.
And how long have you been doing that?
It's been a really long journey for us because we started off very small, and we decided as an organisation that we would not kowtow to the norm of barriers between our communities. So we very much work as we're all one community. We're all working together for a brighter, better future. And the only way you can really do that is by sharing knowledge, sharing education, sharing the stories, making people aware of their Aboriginal history in our region, which has been one of the bloodiest in Australia. So in the 19th century, there were appalling massacres in this area, and they haven't been talked about. Many generations have just been told, no, we can't talk about this. But now we have them 80 metres long, 3 metres high, and they're part of the stories of this region. So they're an important part. So we have 11 screens in total, and two of those screens are devoted to the massacres. And it's pretty no holds barred. We show the massacres, we show the creator spirit, we show the blood that stained the river for days. And at night, all the screens are lit with colours chosen by the elders. This has been very much a project driven by IWC in partnership with the traditional owner elders of this region. And we've been working with the local artist to actually create the whole project. So this is really personal, but what's perfect about it is that the community has really engaged with it, and they are very much welcoming the sharing of this information.
So that community being Indigenous and non-Indigenous community?
Absolutely, absolutely, yes. So we, as an organisation, we provide services to everybody, all people, without barriers. Mm-hmm. We obviously live in an area of very high disadvantage, so about 82.6% of the population, Indigenous and non-Indigenous, is actually classified as being disadvantaged or very disadvantaged by the federal government's social indices. So we say that we are here for Indigenous, disadvantaged, frail, vulnerable, at-risk people. And we know in this region, as with so many places, that people, we all live together. And putting up barriers between the Indigenous and non-Indigenous people isn't achieving anything. So we deliver a whole range of services, medical and health, family and community, and cultural services within a holistic model of care. So we look at the whole person, we look at the kin, we look at the family, and this works very well for non-Indigenous people as well. So while we deliver medical and health and family and community and cultural services to 93% of the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander population in our regions, we also have thousands and thousands of non-Indigenous patients and clients. And we really welcome this bringing together of our people to actually find a way forward.
Janette Young is from the Indigenous Wellbeing Centre, and we're talking about what the centre does, but also the award-winning artwork and historical piece that has been developed and won recently the Premier's Reconciliation Award. Janette, pardon me, I forgot to mention which area you're in. Can you describe that for the people listening tonight?
So we're in, we cover the areas of Bundaberg and North Burnett and a little bit down into the Hervey Bay area. So our footprint's about 42,000 square kilometres. And we provide...
That's a huge area, isn't it?
Well, geographically, yes, it is, yes. We have a lot of transport journeys a year, so which aren't particularly funded, actually. So that's one of the things the government often says, oh, you know, transport's a real barrier, but they don't actually provide the funding for it. So that's another story for another day. But yes, it's been a really exciting project. We came together with the elders. It's taken several years. What we've done is we have a very large health and wellbeing complex here, and we provide that holistic model of care. And we opened up stage one of the IWC Health and Wellbeing Complex back in 2014, and we've opened up the second stage just last year. So it's been a really exciting journey for us. It's a massive complex, and it's open to everybody. We're inclusive. We don't segregate families, Aboriginal families. We don't differentiate. So we are the largest employer of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people in the region, and many of our people, they come to us with not very high skill sets in terms of qualifications, but a lot of community contacts, a lot of community knowledge, and a really great attitude to wanting to move forward and move forward as a community. So we provide about 7,000 hours of accredited training every year to our staff. So all of our staff are fully qualified for the role that they hold. So we don't do tokenism. We don't say, you know, you're an Aboriginal person, you know, we're going to give you a job just to keep people happy and tick a box. That's not how it works. We are all here working side by side, Indigenous and non-Indigenous, to actually make this community a better place. And people come in who are non-Indigenous, and they are provided with services by Indigenous staff, and they are very, very competent and very well qualified.
Janette Young, my guest this evening on ABC Radio Brisbane and Queensland. Janette is from the Indigenous Wellbeing Centre, communications manager there. Janette, this 80-metre-long pictorial depiction of First Nation oral histories, how did this idea develop?
Well, it's funny, really, because it came from a very simple request by council to have screens around the upper level of the two-storey complex that we were building, Stage 2. So we were talking, we yarn with the elders all the time, and someone came up with this idea somewhere along the line that why don't we just do, rather than just do a generic Aboriginal artwork, that many people don't really understand artworks, and although we are working to explain a lot of the symbolism on an ongoing basis, but basically they look at it and they think, oh, that looks pretty, and they don't really know what it means. So what we did was we sat down with a working group of the traditional owner elders of the Tarabalang, who are the traditional owners of the country and of the land that this complex stands on. And over many, many months and years, really, since the first concept, we sat down and we worked out the stories initially and the sacred sites and the history that we really wanted to share. We came up with around 20 ideas or concepts, and we had to whittle those down because we wanted to make them really striking, and we only had so much space. 80 metres is a lot of space, but you're still going to make it striking. So we came down to basically 10, 11 screens, because two of those are for the massacres. We then found a very, very good local artist who came in and worked with us and with the elders and translated those oral histories into images, paintings. So, and meanwhile, I was working with the elders as well, taking down the oral histories and creating the stories, complete with language that will go with the whole project. So now we've ended up. So the pictures were then, or the paintings, I should say, the paintings were then used to create these large aluminium weatherproof screens, which have punched holes. It's very high tech, and at night they are downlit with lights which actually represent the soil, the sky, the rich earth, and of course the ocean, and of course the massacres. So blood red for the massacres, and that light goes on every single night, and it undulates along, and it's very, very mesmerizing. Actually, it's quite stunning. Goes on for about an hour and a half every night, not too late, because you don't want to bother the neighbours, but it's a fantastic fantastic display, and people love it. And the great thing is you can see the pictures in the daytime, but at night it looks absolutely amazing. And you can just see that, and inside we've got all the artworks on display, on permanent display, and we have the plaques with the oral histories written down underneath them. So we're really making it real. We talk about it within our cultural circle as keeping it real, you know, keeping it honest, keeping the integrity.
Yep.
This is real. These are the oral histories as handed down by the ancestors to the elders who are in this community today, and they are so proud, and they're so, it was a really, really it opened up a lot of wounds. There were a lot of tears, there was a lot of emotion during the whole process, but it's been a real pathway towards healing, not only for the elders who are actively involved, but also for the whole community, because suddenly we're now talking about something that's been taboo for so many years, and it's a really healthy thing. You cannot have reconciliation without truth.
This is it. Janette, and often the history of trying to tell these stories to non-Indigenous people has been defensiveness from their part. Oh, you know, don't want to hear about that. Don't want to hear about a past that I had nothing to do with. All those arguments I'm sure you've heard many, many times. So what is happening now then with this artwork? It seems to be that it is opening up a dialogue and saying, this is what we're trying to tell you.
And it's the honest truth as well. It hasn't been written from the perspective of the colonialists. So basically, this has been written by Aboriginal people from their oral histories. So this is real. This is an Aboriginal community-controlled organisation. We are here in the community to help everybody, and, you know, a very, very broad range of services. But also we have, at this complex, we have the largest collection of Indigenous artefacts in the region on permanent display, there for everybody to see all the time. We have culture tours coming through. The Tarabalang Cultural Aboriginal Corporation, they actually come through the centre and they do culture tours, not just of the Indigenous artefacts and now, of course, the screens and the artworks, but they also go to other sacred sites which are featured in the pictorial screens. So there's lots of important places around here, and it's been really a long journey. We talk about this all the time, and it's very interesting how far we have come, because we came really from nowhere, but the whole journey of IWC has been a journey for the community as well. And we really, and people say this to me all the time, that it's created a cultural shift within the whole region in the way that people view reconciliation, the way that the Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples come together, and we're actively looking for solutions together so that we can all move forward to a positive future. And that's really the nub of it. And I think that I'm so proud of everyone who's been involved in it. And, you know, we can't thank them enough for all of their giving. Because it's been a really, really tough thing. Because one of the things that we often say, and again, you know, we talk, we yarn around the table all the time, because this is a really very important journey for the whole of Australia, but also for this community, is that the worst thing you can do to somebody is take what they value most in the world, break it and give it back. And that's what's happened so often before, that people come in very well-meaning, I'm sure, but they take something that's so precious and then they say, well, that's not right, we're going to fix this. Well, don't fix it. Just tell the stories, share the knowledge, share the wisdom, let people learn. And then, only then, as Uncle Willie says, only then can we move on, because true reconciliation requires truth, and we have been working to deliver that truth, and there is 80 metres long, 3 metres high, lit up at night. So you can't go better than that.
Next time in Bundy, I'm going to watch that. I'm going to come and see it. And I'm coming into the cafe because I looked on the internet at the Guava Cafe.
Yes.
And that Sunday that's on that website.
It's too good.
I don't care about the diabetes too. I'm going to starve myself of pasta 2 weeks beforehand, so I'm going to have that little sucker. It looks amazing.
And our cafe is actually a social enterprise cafe. So we do a lot of training through there for, and again, it's, you know, it's everything that we're doing is really about building capacity in the community, but more importantly, making people, each individual person who works here, each person who comes here, understands that they are in charge of themselves, and they have the, and we're here to support people to actually become empowered and to take control of their lives and have the best life they can. And it is a long journey, but do you know what? This award has meant a lot, and it meant a lot to the elders, because for so many years they just haven't felt they've had a voice, and now they feel that for the first time they have been held up there, and this is for them, and it's for the future generations. And the school children come through, and we have parties of government people coming through, and they all go, I didn't know that. I didn't know that. Well, why would they know that? Because no one's talking about it. But it is a beacon of hope and light, as Uncle Billy says, and it's taking everyone away from a dark past that's been wrapped in trauma and half-truths, and now it's real. It's good.
Janette Young, thank you so much. And to anybody who's making their way, we were talking a little bit earlier about the statues that have moved us or pieces of art. And I'm sure that if people go to Bundy, have a look at the IWC. You're in Barrowland Street?
Yeah, corner of Barrowland and Sims Road. And if anyone wants to, they can always go to our site, because Reconciliation Week, unfortunately, because of the COVID, we'd normally it's a big event for us. So we have loads and loads of stuff going on. So this year, I actually moved it all online. So I've got a virtual, had to do something, I couldn't ignore it because it would be so wrong. So we've got a virtual tour of the screens, and we've got a virtual tour of the artifacts. So there's literally hundreds of artifacts. So if anyone's interested, they can take a tour, and if they want to come up in person, they're more than welcome. The centre is open every weekday, and people are more than welcome to come. It's open to everybody.
And that website, iwc.org.au. Janette Young, once again, congratulations on winning the Premier's Reconciliation Award. And I can't wait to see that artwork next time I'm in Bundy. Thank you.
You'll be very welcome. Okay, bye-bye.
The lovely Janette Young.